Schools are typically perceived as a sanctuary for young minds to flourish and prepare for adulthood. Children devote their time and effort to learning, hoping to become the best version of themselves. The responsibility of guiding and nurturing their growth lies with the faculty, who are entrusted to act in the best interest of their pupils. Sometimes, though, the teachers become the enemy. It all started in 1897. That was when the Florida State Reform School was first proposed as a place for delinquent young men and women to be sent in order to get themselves under control before they reached full adulthood. With state governor at the time, William Dunnington Bloxham, being all in on the idea, it was just 3 years later, on January 1st, 1900, that the school officially opened its doors for the first time. Initially, things seemed to be going well as, before long, the school had become self-sustaining on account of the manual labor the children were being made to do without payment on days they weren't in class. When they weren't working or studying, they were being shaped into more law-abiding and ideal citizens by learning to grow their own food, cook their own meals, wash their own clothes, and manufacture their own equipment and tools. But while things may have seemed great on the surface, below that veneer there were some far more sinister acts being carried out, acts which would eventually become apparent to the state. In fact, over the first 13 years of its existence, the school was investigated no less than 6 times, with one of these inspections revealing that many of the boys there were being kept in leg irons in order to restrain them. For as severe as this seems in modern eyes, it wasn't considered a major story at the time. After all, these were young offenders, and if they were going to be prevented from turning into adult ones, then drastic action would sometimes have to be taken when it came to disciplining them. The first real blow to the school's reputation wouldn't occur until 1914, when a dormitory fire killed at least 6 of the boys staying there. With the local media quickly reporting on the disaster, it wasn't long before there was an increased scrutiny over what was happening at the facility. As one article put it, the kids were living in filth and ignorance, with many of them having contracted incurable diseases during their stay. On top of that, not only were there allegations some of the boys had been sent off to work on private farms against the rules of the school, but it was also suggested that a number of the children had been raped by staff. It was a serious accusation, and one which, if true, could have brought about the end of the school. So, perhaps hoping to rebrand themselves and put some distance between the future and the past, later that year the board renamed the school the Florida Industrial School for Boys, with this being the point where it became a male-only establishment. Why male-only? Well, maybe the belief behind it was that further sexual assault seemed less likely to occur in the eyes without women being there. Unfortunately, though, pandemics having no discrimination when it comes to gender, when the Spanish flu hit in 1918, it devastated the school. In fact, records indicate that 99% of the boys there became infected with the virus, with 11 of those dying. A statistically staggering number, which was only helped by the poor conditions, which included lack of drinking water and lights, as well as an inability to remove sewage, which was piling up. This led to further public outcry as, once it became apparent just how poor the conditions had been at the school during the time of the outbreak, there was a strong public desire for reform to be carried out. Thankfully, with their hand now being forced somewhat, the board began enacting changes during the early 1920s which were designed to improve the general conditions and make it an all-around better place to be. The only problem with that was, for as much as these improvements might have helped at first, By the middle of the decade, a swell of students coming in had raised the population there to around 300, twice what the institution was originally designed to hold. This led to not only severe overcrowding, but a resurrection of abusive methods carried out by teachers in order to keep the children in check. In fact, in 1941, the mother of one of the children staying there publicly accused the school of such actions when she reported her son had been beaten bloody with a 3-inch thick wooden board. But that wasn't even the worst of what was going on because, 7 years before that, a 13-year-old boy who'd been sent to the school for trespassing died just 38 days after his arrival. As far as school officials were concerned, though, neither of these incidents represented a failure on their parts. No, the 13-year-old's death had, according to them, nothing to do with any abuse. And as far as the accusations from the other child's mother, while corporal punishment was still considered to be an effective and acceptable form of discipline at the time. With this being the official statement on the matter, it was clear nothing was going to change anytime soon. That attitude only continued on as Arthur G. Dozier, a teacher at the school, began rising up the ranks to the point he was named director of the institution in 1941. With Dozier now in charge, things only got worse as, during the 40s and 50s, the population swelled to around 900, far more than the staff were capable of caring for. Even hiring more people did little to help at this point as there were simply too many children to monitor, with this leading to frequent escape attempts and incidents of violence breaking out. Perhaps even more troubling, though, was the fact that, during this period, where managing the kids became harder than ever, there were reports of a number of boys simply disappearing altogether. As far as what had happened to them, well, while it was never confirmed at the time, it was believed by some that the staff had either beaten or worked them to death and then been forced to get rid of the body after the fact. As one student would later put it, he witnessed a boy fall into an industrial clothes dryer and die while trapped there, and when his body was later removed, a laundry room supervisor barked at the rest of the boys in the nearby vicinity, quote,
"Another one of you little bastards just bit the dust."
Then, on a separate occasion, another survivor of the school reported seeing a boy being beaten then left to die in a bathtub. And these weren't the only examples of such abuse happening. Many of the children there had similar stories, stories which they would carry with them for the rest of their lives. With conditions becoming so abysmal, it must have seemed like the ultimate spit in the face when, after leaving the school in 1957, Arthur G. Dozier was heralded as a great and honorable man who had done much good for the community. In fact, so lionized would he be by the state that, in 1967, 10 years after his exit, the school was renamed the Arthur G. Dozier School for Boys in his honor. But that did little to help the reputation of the institution in the eyes of many members of the local community because by then, stories of the horrors going on there had become so rife that young men in Florida allegedly lived in fear of being sent to Dozier. And that was despite the fact that the school had regularly tried to integrate itself into the community by doing things like allowing locals to drive through the campus at Christmas time and view the festive lights they had on display. Anyone who was really paying attention could see that this was a little more than a thin smokescreen designed to divert attention away from what was really happening. But with few of the boys living there at the time being willing to speak out about the abuse that was taking place, the whole thing was mostly left to lie in the realm of rumor and hearsay. Why wouldn't they speak up? Well, because, like many victims of abuse, they were too humiliated to do so. And even if they felt no embarrassment over what had happened to them, they often feared reprisal should they dare to talk about what was really going on. After all, it wasn't just beatings they had to worry about. It was the threat of being outright murdered. But even if they weren't saying anything, it didn't stop more from coming to light when, in 1968, then-Florida Governor Claude Kirk visited the school and was shocked by the overcrowding and poor conditions he found. At that point, he was even noted as having said the whistle should have been blown on this situation a long time ago. And as for where the worst of these conditions were found, well, that was in the White House, a concrete block detention building designed specifically for students too unreformable or violent to be held elsewhere. Of course, he had no idea just how bad things were in there, though, because, aside from the poor living conditions found inside, that particular building was feared above all else by the students on account of the many boys who went inside and were never seen again. One child even later recalled being ordered to dig 3 holes behind the chow hall one night. Holes which were, in the words of guards R.W. Hatton and Troy Tidwell, to be 4 feet deep and as long as a boy. While he was never told at the time what the holes were to be used for, it was generally understood by all that they were for the victims of the White House. Yes, inside there, the most savage of beatings took place. And by many accounts, it was Hatton and Tidwell who were the main perpetrators. Inside the White House, it wasn't just beatings they were carrying out. No, there was also outright sexual assault going on as well. In fact, according to many of the students there who have since spoken out, an underground space in the White House was informally known by staff as the Rape Room. Not that Governor Kirk was made aware of that at the time, though. As far as he knew, it was just an overcrowded institution with conditions that weren't up to standard. That was why, feeling like reform was needed, he not only helped to ensure the White House was closed down soon afterward, but he also pushed for corporal punishment to officially be outlawed on school grounds. Something that eventually happened later that same year. A year after that, partially as a result of the poor job the previous owners had been doing, the school would come under new management again when the Division of Youth Services, a subsection of the Department of Health and Rehabilitative Services, formally took control. Still though, that wouldn't be the end of the abuse carried out at the Dozier School because in 1982, a further inspection revealed several of the children there were being hogtied and kept in isolation for weeks at a time as a form of punishment. That caused so much of an outcry that it led to the American Civil Liberties Union filing a lawsuit which, combined with other active federal suits concerning conditions at the school, led to the Department of Justice starting to monitor Florida's juvenile justice system in 1987. Of course, by that point, calling Dozier a school for juveniles was starting to stretch the definition of the word. While initially it had only been young men between the ages of 10 and 16 who were allowed to stay there, come the late 80s, people as old as 21 were still a part of the system. According to further reports which came to light around this time, many of these young men were still being abused. But who was responsible for finally leaking this information to the public? Well, that's where the White House boys come into the story. Towards the end of the millennium, a number of former students of the Dozier School came together to share accounts of the horror stories they'd either witnessed or were directly subjugated to during their time there. Among these stories were not only incidents of repeated physical abuse and rape, but also of outright murder taking place on the grounds. Realizing nothing was going to be done about it unless they did something themselves, under the leadership of Roger Dean Kaiser, they formally organized in 1998 as a group named the White House Boys, a reference to the infamous detention center at the school. As they were starting to speak out publicly about some of the worst tales they'd seen, conditions at the school itself were only continuing to slide. In fact, even after it was officially placed under the management of the Florida Department of Juvenile Justice in 1994, an influx of more violent offenders being brought in only made things worse. Hell, in 2007, some of the abuses taking place there were even caught on camera for the first time when CCTV footage leaked to the media showed 18-year-old Justin Caldwell being grabbed by the throat and slammed backwards onto the ground. With this, combined with the stories the White House boys were reporting to prominent media outlets such as the St. Petersburg Times, only increasing the spotlight on the Dozier School, it meant further investigations would be carried out. This led to the acting superintendent of the school, as well as a number of employees, being fired in April of that same year. But that would only be the beginning, because a year later, Florida Governor Charlie Crist directed the Florida Department of Law Enforcement to further investigate allegations of abuse, torture, and murder which had been recounted to him by the White House boys. Like with anything bureaucratic, it would be a slow process, and it wouldn't be until 2010 that a formal report was filed. What did the report say? Well, while 31 graves had been dug at the facility between 1914 and 1952, these had all been officially recorded at the time, and there was no evidence to suggest any of the deaths were caused by staff or that any of the bodies were deliberately concealed. Of course, none of that explained the fact that none of the bodies were exhumed as part of the investigation, something that makes it extremely difficult to determine a cause of death. Was there a reason behind that? Was someone perhaps protecting someone else? That's unclear. But what is clear is that, by that point, the state of Florida was officially acknowledging the abuses that had taken place at the Dozier School for Boys. And as a result, not only would a historic plaque be installed on the site of the White House in remembrance of what had occurred, but in 2009, the school officially failed its annual inspection on the grounds of being unable to move on from a long-standing culture of violence and abuse. That was why, in June of 2011, after plans to merge Dozier School with the Jackson Juvenile Offender Center fell through, the infamous school was closed down and all remaining students were sent to other facilities around the state. While this did give the White House boys and other victims some sense of closure, it didn't allow them any compensation for what they had gone through. No, after having filed a class action lawsuit the year prior seeking damages against the state government, they were told it was impossible as the statute of limitations had already run out. Realizing they couldn't let these victims go without anything on account of a technicality, the Florida legislature did introduce a bill in 2012 that provided financial compensation for the victims of the Dozier School, a bill that was finally signed in March of 2014 and authorized up to $7,500 per burial for families who wanted to reinter the remains of their relatives who'd been left in unmarked graves at the school. After failing to dig up the graves during a prior investigation, in 2013, once the full details of what had been occurring came to light, a court injunction was made to force the exhumation of the bodies on site so they could be laid to rest according to their family's wishes. That would begin on August 6th, when a permit was formally issued allowing a team of University of South Florida anthropologists and archaeologists to excavate the grounds. Once there, though, to the shock of everyone, they found a scene far worse than they could have ever imagined as a full 55 graves were discovered, almost twice the amount which was officially documented by the school. And of the bodies unearthed at that time, forensic investigation would deem many of them to have died of things like gunshot wounds, blunt force trauma, and even malnutrition. But that wasn't all, because on top of that, it was believed that a second gravesite existed as by now, nearly 100 potential deaths at the Dozier School had been unearthed by talking to those who'd attended it. The existence of such a location made perfect sense to those involved in trying to figure out the truth because, with the school being segregated for so many years, a gravesite for black students and a gravesite for white students would have been standard operating procedure. As it currently stands, though, the grave site for white students has yet to be officially found. With one half of the victims now seemingly accounted for, it means DNA testing has been able to take place in order to identify any of the bodies who are not documented in Dozier's records. But even that's been a tricky thing to accomplish, especially when so much decomposition has already taken place. To this day, only 7 of the 51 corpses discovered at the Dozier School have been identified, with the ideas of a further 14 being presumed. As for the remaining 30, well, their families will still have to wait for confirmation that their loved ones did indeed die there. And when it comes to the white students' graves, while no official discovery has been made yet, during a pollution cleanup on the site of the former school in March of 2019, a potential 27 further points of interest were stumbled upon. We have to say potential for now because, as of the spring of 2023, this new site is yet to be investigated, though under the direction of Florida State Governor Ron DeSantis, movement is being made in that direction. University of South Florida forensic anthropologist Dr. Aaron Kimmery, a key part of the original excavation team, has already announced her intentions to return and see if there are indeed more graves there. While everyone waits for this to happen, the story has been kept in the public eye through numerous non-fiction true crime books such as Roger Dean Kaiser's The White House Boys and Elizabeth A. Murray's The Dozier School for Boys. It's also been fictionalized in the Pulitzer Prize-winning 2020 novel The Nickel Boys by Colson Whitehead. We can only hope this keeps the horrors of the Dozier School for Boys at the forefront of people's minds for long enough that those final graves can be unearthed. And when that's done, we hope any further locations still out there can be found too, as the very least which can be done for the victims now is to give them a proper burial. Sure, it won't make up for the pain and misery they had to endure while enrolled there, and it won't make up for the fact that such acts were allowed to continue for over a century despite there being so many red flags. But once everyone is accounted for and this dark chapter of history can finally be closed, it might at least serve as a reminder that children are our most precious resource and, if we want to succeed as a society, we have to ensure that we take care of them and foster them while they're growing up, not abuse them and treat them like garbage, deserving of being beaten and thrown away. Thanks for letting us tell you this sinister story. If you enjoyed it, subscribe on whatever platform you're on and hit like, rate it, or leave a comment. Join us next week when we'll take you somewhere sinister.